everyone, welcome to Current Affairs for Beginners. In today's session, we'll cover yesterday's and today's paper. Most of the students were asking to do us analysis, give us a detailed analysis of the article. But we should tell here that the concept of our core is to make the students understand the Hindu paper in a better way, to make them read in a better way, especially we are focusing on the beginners. Here what we will do is, for example, if you are reading an article, in that article you found a word, for example, let us take habeas corpus, which you don't know again, or else you have to refer back to your books. So in this video we will tell you the meaning of this habeas corpus. Here we will cover various things like some terms, institutions, organizations like World Bank, World Trade Organization, what are all these. We will tell you what is its mission and what is the objective of it. If there is any scheme that appeared in the paper, we'll tell about it. But we will not do any analysis of that article. Now let's start our today's session. Before starting our today's session, first we'll see answers for the questions from our previous video. The first question is, the term marginal cost of lending rate, sometimes appeared in news, is used in relation to banking operations, communications networking, military strategy, supply and demand of agriculture products. It is banking operations. First, we should know what is meant by this marginal cost of funds-based lending rate. It is MCLR. It is the minimum interest rate below which a bank cannot lend to its customers. But there is an exception to this. If RBI allows the banks to lend below this marginal cost of lending rate in some exceptional cases, then the banks were allowed to lend below this interest rate. But in generally, they are not supposed to lend below this interest rate. It is the minimum interest rate below which a bank cannot lend. The next question is, consider the following statements. In tropical regions, Zika virus disease is transmitted by the same mosquito that transmits dengue. What is that mosquito? It is the female Aedes aegypti mosquito. This is the mosquito which is responsible for spreading dengue and chikungunya viruses. The next one is, sexual transmission of Zika virus disease is possible. Yes. Zika can be passed through sex from a person who has Zika virus to his partner. So this statement is also correct. As both the statements are correct, the answer here is both 1 and 2. It is C. Our first article is, deny MSP to stubble burners, says the National Green Tribunal. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of environment. And the subtopic is air pollution. From this article, now we are going to see about two things. One is, what is meant by this MSP and what is this National Green Tribunal? First, we'll see about this National Green Tribunal. What is a tribunal, first of all? It is an administrative body that is established in order to resolve disputes between the aggrieved members. These tribunals were established especially to relieve the burden of our judiciary, that is our courts. And the other purpose for which these tribunals will be established is to deliver a quick and speedy justice. For these purposes, it will be established. So what about this National Green Tribunal now? This National Green Tribunal is a statutory body, and this body derives its powers from an act known as National Green Tribunal Act of 2010. This act has replaced a previously existing authority known as National Environment Appellate Authority. This act has provision to set up a tribunal called as National Green Tribunal by replacing this National Environment Appellate Authority. This tribunal will provide very effective and speedy justice in case of matters related to environmental protection and conservation of forests and other natural resources, including enforcement of any legal right that is related to environment. This National Green Tribunal will dispose the cases that were related to environment protection and conservation of forests and natural resources and in the implementation of any law that is related to environmental laws. And this tribunal consists of a chairperson along with some judicial members from the judiciary and some experts in matters related to the environment. And this chairperson, he should be either a judge of India's Supreme Court or Chief Justice of a High Court in India. And the next one is MSP, Minimum Support Price. It is the price at which government will purchase the produce from farmers. It is the price at which the government will purchase the produce from farmers at the price that is announced before sowing season, not after the harvest, but before the sowing season itself, government will announce this minimum support price. For example, let us take paddy. Government will announce this minimum support price for this paddy. After harvest, due to any market reasons or if there is an increase in the supply of paddy, the price of this paddy may go down below this minimum support price that is announced by the government. Then farmers can sell their produce to the government at the minimum support price instead of selling to the market price, which is lesser than the minimum support price. So who will decide this MSP? It is the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs which will decide this minimum support price. And to this committee, it is the Commission for Agricultural Costs and Prices will recommend this minimum support price. It is this commission which will calculate and recommend this MSP to the Cabinet Committee on Economic Affairs. This commission is under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. Along with this minimum support price, there were two more prices which needs to be known. One is known as procurement price and the other is issue price. Procurement price is the price at which the government will procure the produce from the farmers. This procurement price is initially announced post-harvest season. Now, this is not being announced, only the MSP is being considered as the procurement price also. This will be announced at the post-harvest and it is a bit higher than the minimum support price. And the other price is issue price. Issue price is the price at which the Food Corporation of India will sell these food grains to the public distribution system, through which public will get their ration from this public distribution system. And this is the price at which the Food Corporation of India will sell the food grains that were procured through MSP or the procurement price. Those food grains will be sold at the issue price by the Food Corporation of India to the PDS. Our next article is, Iran is honoring the 2015 nuclear deal, says International Atomic Energy Agency. What is this International Atomic Energy Agency? This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of international organizations, various international organizations. So what is this International Atomic Energy Agency? It is an international organization that works in the area of promoting peaceful use of nuclear energy in order to prohibit its use in the military, as well as it will prohibit its use and also the manufacture of nuclear weapons. As an independent body, it is not under any other organization. It is an independent body. It works to develop peaceful applications of this nuclear technology by the countries, whoever owns this nuclear technology. And it will also provide some international safeguards against the misuse of this nuclear technology as well as nuclear materials. Along with these safeguards, it will also provide nuclear safety as well as nuclear security standards and along with their implementation. Our next article is IIP growth falters as inflation eases. This article comes under GS paper 3 under the topic of economy. From this article, now we are going to see about what is meant by this IIP as well as inflation. We know that GDP, a gross domestic product, is a measure of the overall activity of production, overall production of goods and services in an economy. This GDP, the gross domestic product, will measure the overall production of goods and services in an economy. Whereas, do we have any index to measure only industrial activity in the Indian economy? Yes. That index is known as Index of Industrial Production. This index will help us to understand the growth of various industrial sectors in the economy, like mining, electricity, and manufacturing. So, to put it simply, it is just an indicator of industrial growth in the Indian economy. And the present base year on which, based on which this will be calculated, is 2011-12 is the base year. Now let us see this with an example. For example, in 2011-12, the IIP, this index is 100. Let us assume it is 100. Now in 2017 and 2018, it is around 180. This indicates that there is an 80% industrial growth compared to the base year. In the present year, there is an 80% growth compared to 2011 and 2012. Who releases this index? This index is released by the Central Statistics Office that functions under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. The next one is inflation. Inflation is a situation where there is a continuous increase in the general price level and decrease in the purchasing power of money. That situation is known as inflation. To put it simply, it is a general level of rise in prices. If we see this with an example, for example, 2 days ago, you bought 5 kgs of rice for 100 rupees. This means the cost of 1 kg rice is 20 rupees. Then, if you approach the same shopkeeper to purchase this 5 kgs of rice at 100 rupees, but the shopkeeper, once you paid the 100 rupees, he gave you only 4 kgs of rice. He also said that the price of rice has increased and now it is 1 kg is 25 rupees. So from this example, we can clearly say that For 100 rupees, previously we got 5 kgs of rice. But for the same 100 rupees, now we are getting a lesser quantity. That means the value of this 100 rupee has gone down. Which means the purchasing power of 100 rupees, this money has reduced due to increase in price. There is a rise in the price along with decrease in the purchasing power of money. And this situation is known as inflation. Our next article is RBI unlikely to open window for NBFCs. This article comes under GS paper 3 under the topic of economy. From this article here, we are going to see about NBFCs. We have already seen about this so many times, but now again we'll see it in brief. NBFCs, non-banking financial companies. This is a company. From the name itself, we can say non-banking financial company. It is a company which got its powers to function from an act known as Companies Act of 1956. And here we can see it is a non-banking. It's not a bank. It is a company which is involved in various businesses like loans and advances, acquisition, that is to acquire shares, stocks, bonds, debentures or securities that were issued by the government or any local authority. Securities in the sense, it is a collateral used to lend the money. And it is also involved in businesses like insurance, chit fund businesses, but it does not engage in any business that is related to agricultural activity, industrial activity, and especially the purchase or sale of any goods. It is involved in the purchase and sale of securities, which is a collateral used to lend the money at a maturity period, whereas it does not involve in purchase or sale of any goods or services. It will not even provide any services like banks. Along with goods, it does not even involve in purchase, sale of any and construction of any immovable property like houses, all these. These are the areas to which it is restricted to engage its business in. And along with these, it a non-banking institute which cannot lend but can only receive deposits in installments or in a lump sum. This institute, a non-banking institute which we can only receive deposits, is also known as a non-banking financial company. Now, let us see some of the differences between a bank and a non-banking financial company. We said it is not a bank, but just like a bank, it will also lend to its customers and it will also make investments from the deposits it receives. But still there are some differences between a bank and a non-banking financial company, because a non-banking financial company cannot accept demand deposits. Demand deposit in the sense, this is the amount that can be withdrawn without giving any prior notice. Now, for example, I have deposited in a bank called SBI. Whenever I need money, I use my ATM card to withdraw that money without any prior notice to the bank. But whereas when it comes to a fixed deposit, there will be a maturity time. I cannot withdraw it whenever I wish. So now, these non-banking financial companies cannot accept this demand deposits, which can be withdrawn without any prior notice. And one more thing is deposit insurance facility. In banks, we had a facility known as deposit insurance. For the amount that we deposit, we will get insurance up to 1 lakh rupees by a organization. We have seen about this organization few days back. It is the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation. This will insure our amount whichever we deposit for up to 1 lakh rupees. Whereas this facility is not available for the amount that we deposit, we will not get any insurance in this non-banking financial companies like we get in case of banks. And these non-banking financial companies are regulated by multiple regulators, whereas our banks are regulated only by one authority, which is the Reserve Bank of India. Whereas these NBFCs are regulated by various regulators because they're of different types. Here itself we have seen these NBFCs are involved in various, engaged in various sectors. Like if it is an insurance company, then it is regulated by Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority. Whereas if it is a merchant bank, then it is regulated by SEBI. The stocks, all this, it is regulated by Securities Exchange Board of India. If it is a microfinance institution, we have already seen these institutions will lend to the MSMEs. These are regulated by state government, RBI and NABARD. So they are having different regulators, whereas a bank is having only one regulator, it is the Reserve Bank of India. And we know there is a norm known as public sector lending. This concept is not applicable to these non-banking financial companies. Public sector lending is a specified portion of banks lending. Banks, we know that banks will lend to its customers. In the amount that bank has kept aside to lend to its customers, some amount has to be provided for few specific sectors like agriculture and allied activities, micro, small and medium enterprises like MSMEs, and for poor people for their housing, students for education, and for low income groups and weaker sections. For these reasons, RBI will ask these banks to set aside some amount for this public sector lending, and these are the areas to which it has to lend. This concept of public sector lending is not there with this non-banking financial companies. And one more thing is cash reserve requirement, CRR, cash reserve ratio. It is the amount the banks has to keep with RBI out of their net demand and time liabilities. Out of the amount the bank owns, a certain amount has to be kept with RBI. All the banks are bound to do so. This is not there for these non-banking financial companies. Our next article is Cyclone Clouds, ISRO's GSAT-29 launch plan. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of Science and Technology. From this article here, we are going to see about this GSAT-29. Whenever anything related to satellites, missiles, all these appear in paper, just note down about it and its technicalities, some specifications for prelims. Now, if we see this GSAT-29, it is a 3500 kg of communication satellite, which is used to provide high quality internet services. ISRO is planning to put this communication satellite known as GSAT-29 in GSLV. To launch this satellite, we need a launch vehicle, and they are going to use this geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle Mark 3, which is a three-stage solid, liquid and cryogenic heavy lift launch vehicle. Initially, this launch vehicle will inject the satellite into a geosynchronous transfer orbit with required inclination to the equator, and then it will place this satellite into a geostationary orbit. And the lifespan of this satellite is 10 years. Our next article is Saudi in talks to cut crude output. Though this article comes under GS paper 3 under the topic of economy, here there is an organization known as OPEC. It comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of various international organizations. Now we'll see about this OPEC. Organization for Petroleum Exporting Countries. Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries is an intergovernmental organization of 14 countries. The governments of 14 oil exporting countries have grouped into an organization known as OPEC. And these 14 oil exporting nations coordinates all its member countries in order to unify, that is, to have a uniform petroleum policies among its member countries. To give power to this uniform petroleum policies among its nations, they work on a principle of unanimity, that is, one member will have one vote. And this organization will set out the production targets for its member nations. Based on this target only, all these 14 oil exporting nations should produce this oil. And when the production is decreased, it leads to increase in oil prices. If we see who are all those 14 members of this organization, they are Iran, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, Algeria, Angola, Libya, Nigeria, Equatorial Guinea and Gabon, Ecuador and Venezuela. These two are from South or Latin America. The next article is India-Singapore begin sea drills. This article comes under GS paper 2 under the topic of international relations. From this article, here we are going to see about SIMBEX as well as ASEAN. SIMBEX is an acronym for Singapore India Maritime Bilateral Exercise. SIMBEX, Singapore India Maritime Bilateral Exercise. It is a joint naval exercise. From this itself, we can see it is a maritime. That means it is a naval exercise between two countries named India and Singapore. So from the prelims point of view, what is important is we should know about this exercise, whether it is a military exercise or a naval exercise and between which countries. Like this, if any other naval exercises or defense related exercises appear in paper, just note it down. Like Mitra Shakti, it is between the India and Sri Lankan joint military exercise. Whereas Nomadic Elephant, it is a joint military exercise between India and Mongolia. Like this, whenever any defense exercises appear in paper, just note it down. And the next one is ASEAN, Association of Southeast Asian Nations. It is an intergovernmental organization of 10 Southeast Asian nations. And these 10 Southeast Asian nations, they have grouped into this ASEAN in order to cooperate and facilitate economic, political, security, military, educational and socio-cultural integration among these 10 member ASEAN countries. And these 10 member ASEAN comprises of Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Singapore, Philippines, Vietnam, Myanmar, Cambodia, Brunei and Laos. India is not a member of this Association of Southeast Asian Nations, but it is a full-time dialogue partner of this association. Our next article is Ripples of Discord. This article comes under GS Paper 3 under the topic of Science and Technology. Here we are going to see about LIGO, a laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory. We know that we can detect objects that will emit electromagnetic radiations. Electromagnetic radiations like X-rays, gamma rays, all this. We can detect the objects that will emit these X-rays, gamma rays through our telescope. But by merging two black holes, they will not emit these electromagnetic radiations, but they will emit gravitational waves. These will be detected by using this laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory. First, we should know what are these gravitational waves. We know that if we drag our hand in a pond, the water is very still. So if we drag our hand, then we can see ripples like this in the water. Now, by merging two black holes also, they will send waves around them, and these waves travel at a speed of light, just like ripples in the pond. These waves are called as gravitational waves. These waves are extremely weak and are very difficult to be detected. So if we see this interferometer in this LIGO, this interferometer are the investigative tools used in many fields of science and engineering. These investigative tools are called as interferometers because these tools, they work by merging two or more sources of light in order to create an interference pattern. This pattern can be measured and it can also be analyzed. That's why these are called as interferometer, which can be inferred. The pattern of which can be inferred and it can also be analyzed. Now let's see our today's questions. The first one is, who among the following is responsible for releasing the index of industrial production? And the next one is, consider the following statements with regard to non-banking financial companies. They cannot accept demand deposits like banks. Demand insurance facility is available in case of fixed deposits in NBFCs. Try to answer these questions and post your answers in the comment box. We'll see a detailed explanation for these questions in our tomorrow's video. Thank you.